We may be seeing a more broader acceptance of Bitcoin, but we also started the show talking about Bitcoin and another much less serious cryptocurrency, Dogecoin. The idea that Dogecoin can blow up, that Elon Musk is tweeting about Bitcoin and Dogecoin, does that undermine or taint Bitcoin by association?
No, I mean, it's one of these things where, you know, Dogecoin is meant to be sort of fun and a meme. It's kind of like, you know, the internet can be used for sending silly memes, but also for serious business at the same time. And crypto is like a financial internet. So you can trade meme stocks or meme coins on it, but also send real things.
Right. But this era that we're in, and certainly we've seen this over the last few weeks, the power of meme stocks of, you know, a group of retail investors, does that risk being confused? Does it risk scaring off more institutional investors, corporations, or countries eventually?
Well, I think, you know, the internet is just influencing everything. And so the normal financial system is going to become more crypto-like, just like, you know, media became more internet-like and politics, for better or worse, became more internet-like. So I don't think it scares it off. I think we just see a convergence of the two.
Balaji, I'm curious. I mean, if we're going to start talking about countries buying the currency for national security purposes, how price sensitive do they need to be? I mean, do they need to wait for it to drop 50 to 80% before getting in, trying to ride waves of prior valuations?
Well, I mean, the thing is that it's, in one sense, buying digital gold is similar to buying gold. Like, you know, central banks actually hold huge amounts of gold. I wrote an article on this. It's pinned to my top of my Twitter. They hold six, you know, India, for example, holds 600 tons of gold. The U.S. has like 8,000 tons. So the difference, though, is that buying digital gold, unlike gold, digital gold is still in its massive price appreciation phase. Personally, I think that if you're a long-term investor, you should just basically buy now. You know, I mean, I've been saying this stuff not when Bitcoin's at 40,000 or whatever the price is right now, but since, you know, Bitcoin was at like a dollar or less than $10. So, you know, I've been consistent on this for many years. The Anderson Horowitz, we bought very, very early. And so I think that it's still on the ascent, though, because, you know, maybe like 1% of the world or thereabouts holds BTC. To wait for it to drop 50 to 80%, you might have it appreciate 5x in the meantime. So it's hard to time that. But what you can know is that in 5 or 10 years, it's going to become probably much more valuable.
Right. We have had some, I mean, well-established money managers, Bill Miller comes to mind, who has come around to the idea of saying, look, take 1% of your cash and put it into Bitcoin. Are you advising anyone from on a retail front, average households who have the income and the means to do this, to do that?
Well, you know, I'm not giving specific financial advice. You know, everybody's going to have their own situation. But, you know, like, I do know that there are people, for example, who've kept several years, you know, maybe, you know, of cash as a cushion. But the thing is, whatever you invest in crypto, because it's volatile enough, it can go up 10x, it can go down 90%. But over the long term, it's appreciated several orders of magnitude. So whatever you put into crypto has to be money that you don't need to touch for a long time. So that 1% rule, I think, makes sense from that perspective, because, you know, you don't have to tap into that money to pay operating expenses. If you do need to tap into the money, then you might have to liquidate it when the price is down, and then that's how you take a loss.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.